Now I'm just a guy who's carrying a saber around New York City and people are staring at me like, what is that? I'm like, oh my God, is that a sword?
The guy has a spear.
That's seriously, right?
Fencing is one of the oldest Olympic sports in modern Olympic history.
It's really incredible that fencing is the only combat sport with no weight classes. Did you know the tip of a fencing blade moves as fast as a speeding bullet?
This is a science of fencing with me, Cleo Thompson.
My name is Edwin Sue, and I'm an orthopedic surgeon at HSS.
My name is Cleo Thompson, and I'm a men's saber fencer for the Team USA. In 2008 was the first time I saw fencing in the Olympics for the first time. So when I was 16, it was my first time going overseas for a fencing tournament. Fencing is a little weird because there's different coordinations you have to have for your feet, your hand, and while maintaining balance in your body. And I tend to think of it like jazz music, where somehow everyone's still kind of doing something different, but it still works and it sounds beautifully.
It's a sport that combines the grace, the coordination, the agility of someone like a dancer with the explosiveness of a sprinter, the reaction time of a race car driver, and all the time they're facing an opponent in hand-to-hand combat. Fencing is definitely an asymmetric sport. He's left-hand dominant.
We step forward just a little bit, make sure our feet are shoulder length apart, and we hold, sit down in a squatting position.
Think of a plié in ballet, contracting his quadriceps to support his knees in that flex position. His gluteal muscles are contracted. He's holding that squat in a ready position. His upper arm has to be extended, so he's got his deltoids firing and his biceps holding his weapon at the level. He's got his wrist extensors and his finger flexors and extensors gripping the weapon. When I see Khalil in these different movements and positions, I'm seeing his hips. I'm seeing the ball and socket joint moving around. In that front leg, he's creating tremendous hyperflexion, which can put pressure against the labrum. In that back leg, he's in an extended position, and that's putting pressure on the hip capsule as well as the hip flexor. The attack is essentially a lunge. Khalil has to explode from his position in such a way and cover so much ground. I think he can cover almost 3 meters with a lunge, and he has to try to reach his opponent to score a point. That's gonna involve tremendous pressure and force from his back leg. So his back leg is exploding up with force from his gastroc, his quadriceps, his gluteal muscles.
When you recover from a lunge, you're using your lower back and your hamstrings to pull you back.
He's then extending his shoulder, his triceps, his wrist extensors to extend the reach of his arm and putting a lot of force on that front leg when he lands. So it's been said that that front leg will see 7 times body weight with that forward lunge.
Ready, fence.
Khalil has to be able to switch from attack to defense in a millisecond. So he is lunging forward, but then he's also prepared to retreat. He's gonna have his core being able to stabilize his body and twisting and avoidance maneuvers.
We fence on a 14-minute long, 1.5 meters wide strip. Myself and my opponent start here and here. And this is what we call the box in saber fencing. Center of the strip is about 4 meters apart. Looks super far, but you can feel, you can smell another person's breath. And like, in that moment, you're fighting to control and like just get that, just find some way to win. Proper way to hold a saber is you take your thumb, place it right here on the grip of the weapon, and wrap your index finger around. These two fingers are basically key to moving your weapon. Additionally, everything you do comes from your fingers and your wrist, like so.
A lot of the movements in fencing really just come from his two fingers, his thumb and his index finger, being able to control that blade. So they have to have tremendous dexterity and strength.
And really the other three fingers are just used to have stability and hold your weapon. So think of it here, I'm moving using my pinky, middle, and ring finger to help move it, but any motion towards actually hitting my opponent
cutting. So we cut a cut like this, point thrust. We cut to the belly, under the arm. Additionally, do the same thing, what we call a parry.
I think the weapon becomes an extension of one's body. He's so accustomed to knowing where that tip of the blade is going to end in space that it really becomes a feel for him. And he has practiced these movements so many times. He knows where the tip of the blade is going at any one time with a certain movement. He has tremendous hand-eye coordination, but he doesn't actually need to have good vision. There was a story where he had some difficulty hitting a baseball when he was younger because he needed glasses. But in fencing, I think it may actually be an advantage because he doesn't need to rely on his eyesight. Khalil is basically processing this in milliseconds. He's looking at his opponent. He's looking at their movements, but he's also listening to their rhythm. So he can really detect some movements that are going to come and the rhythm that an opponent has by listening.
I could do a rhythm of 1, 2, 3, 4. My opponent starts after me, though. That means I'm falling into their rhythm. It's like a dance, but you're fighting with them. And that's the part where it's very difficult, because you could set a rhythm, but then you're only moving on your own. If you're not moving with your opponent, you're not interacting with them, you're basically fencing alone, and you're just allowing them to do whatever they want. So in order for that to happen, you have to find a way to break the rhythm. Either you start before your opponent, or you set the rhythm. You start with them, matching the rhythm, or you start after them, where you break the rhythm. Find that step that makes them uncomfortable.
So he does want to break the rhythm, but also not make it clear to the opponent what he's doing. So he has to disguise it. So he has to have really fine motor control. I think there's that level of tension in the muscles always being ready in a certain position to extend that blade in a way that his opponent can't necessarily tell it's coming.
One, one, two. Now, in that pause, he does 1, 1, 2. I do this, 1, 1, 2. So I accelerate before he can even start his second step. So he's here, 1, 1, 2, I do. Just to throw him off. The whole point is to make changes so no one can follow you, and then eventually take control and take control of the rhythm of the match.
It's like a dance, but you're fighting.
Key things in fencing are agility, acceleration, speed, and strength.
Strength and acceleration, that's gonna come from the large muscles. So it's gonna be gluteal muscles, hamstrings, quadriceps, gastrocs. Those are powerful muscles that are gonna provide explosive propelling force.
Holding these weapons and having to know everything in the proper technique and using everything in small motions is very tiring on the body. Go.
Agility is the ability to move really quickly and respond to things, so that's gonna come from smaller muscles.
You have to be able to move back and forth, but also as fast, literally right then there, the snap.
Khalil is constantly working on footwork.
A lot of workouts just on acceleration between a short distance of like 10 meters, just so I can be able to cover ground. Go. I'll do a lot of sprinting. I'll do full body workouts because I have to. Squats, deadlifts. Most important muscle groups we use are our core for stability, being able to help just change direction, our hamstrings, hips, and glutes.
Stability is going to come from the core, so that's going to come from the large muscles that are stabilizing his core, which are the abdominals and the paraspinal muscles.
My teammate said to me, you want to be good, but you should want to be great. And I had a moment where I was like, what does that even mean? And then, like, it took time, I thought about it, and I said, you know, I want to be great. And he was like, greatness is a choice. Why do you show up to wherever you're going? What is your point of leaving the house? Greatness isn't something that's going to be achieved in a week or a month. You have to train your body to react properly in those situations. So it takes a lot of discipline, constant work, to be one of the best players, best at something.